so as you no doubt guessed, today I'm going to be talking a bit about debugs. So for those of you who actually looked at the code, this diagram is eminently familiar. To those of you who just send down to the BTS and things magically happen, you probably have no idea what goes on in between the mail in and CGI boxes. Okay. So just in the interest of kind of explaining what we're going to talk about a little bit, basically the way mail works is mail comes in, goes through spam processing called spam scan, then gets kicked to a script called process all. So each of these steps has different queues with different letters. It's kind of neat and confusing. Which then kicks the message to two separate scripts. One's process, one's service. Process is what does all of the bug number at processing. And service is what handles all the control and request messages. So if you send a message to control at bugs.bugnumber.org, it goes to service. If you send a message to bug number dash whatever, it goes to process. Then all those tie together into a single database, flat files, that's in the db-h directory, and that directory has a hash based on hash 100 of the bug number, and in that directory there's a log file, which has a very interesting file format, there's a summary file, and a status file. Anyway, all that feeds into a set of indexes, which we then use to query with CGI programs. Later I'll tell you a little bit about the SOAP backend, and basically everything else that you see operates off of db-h. Okay, so in today's talk, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the versioning and how that works, and I'm also going to talk to you a little bit about some of the recent feature enhancements that have been put into the BTS. I'm going to assume everybody kind of knows how to use it. And I'm going to talk then about some of the things that I have planned in the future, and hopefully during the question part, and also during the block, and I believe that's tomorrow at 11 o'clock, you all can give more suggestions on things that you'd like to see. So the version information basically comes from DAC. It tracks the versions from which a package is descended. So that means that if you upload a package today that's version, I don't know, 1.1.5, or 1.1-5. Okay. If the change log matches a package which has been descended from 1.1.4, okay, then all the bugs that were applicable in 1.1.4 or 1.1-4 that haven't yet been fixed in 1.1-5 are still present in 1.1-5. Okay. That's the basic hypothesis behind which the BTS versioning system works. All the versions are tracked by a source package version number compilation. This means that if you see version numbers that don't match the name or the version number of your binary package because you're insane and your binary package version numbers don't match your source version for very good reasons, whatever those cockamamie reasons are, then that's why. It's because we track it by the version number of the source package. So we have a whole set of mappings to go back and forth between what the hell version number is this source package on architecture that's crazy to what the actual source package was that somebody uploaded. Because again, just because you have one binary package on one architecture doesn't mean that it's built from the same source on every architecture. It'd be nice if that was the case, but it's not necessarily the way it is. And all of this information is accessible via Debug's versions. One of the big things that I've been working on, and I wasn't actually responsible for Debug's versions itself, that's Colin Lawson and Anthony Towns who did most of the heavy lifting there. But one of the other things that I've been doing is, throughout the couple years that I've been working on the BTS, is abstracting out a lot of the functionality that's been hidden, unfortunately, in various modules that were sourced directly. So now what you can do, if you like Perl at all, is you can use individual modules to interact with the BTS. And this is the start of that, even though I didn't write it. So the way you can set versions, obviously by initially submitting the bug, if you submit it with a version header, and it'll set the version. One of the, hopefully this means that the version pseudo header is actually accurate. We don't currently check to see if it's a version that we know about. And there are a couple reasons for that, one of which is the fact that the BTS doesn't necessarily know, because it lags a little bit behind what DAC is doing. It doesn't necessarily know when all the versions are out in the wild. Of course, before recently, we didn't actually even check to see if it was a policy compliant version number, but we do that now. So at least we reject version numbers that can't possibly be correct. I think report bug, like 3.33 or something, was setting version numbers to NA, which had the unfortunate property of not being clearable by any other command to the BTS. So this at least should clear that up. The way you set versions, if you find a bug in a package, you can send a control message, found bug number, the version number. I believe now it works so that you can actually give it the source slash version number combination. But that again assumes that you know what the right source is and the right version number for the source package that corresponds to your binary package. If for some reason found and somebody is screwed up, you can use not found. And it'll reverse a specific found message. I've recently changed the way found works slightly. So now, if you send a found, and you have found a bug in a version, which according to dpackage compare versions, well, equivalent implementation of it, is strictly later than any fixed version, it reopens the bug. So that's a little change there as well. It used to be if it was only the last fixed version was equivalent to the last found version, then it would reopen the bug. Yeah, it was. So this confused people to know when they found the version that was later, that it didn't undone the bug. And I'm going to explain a little bit the difference between done and buggy, because a lot of people get that confused. Then to actually notice that a bug has been fixed, there are a couple different ways that you can do this. One, you can use the control interface, just say fix bug number version, okay, that'll mark it as fixed, or you can send a version done message. If you send a version done message, make sure that you're sending it with the proper version number. We'll see an example later of somebody who sent one with a version number that doesn't exist. And that doesn't do you any good as far as versioning goes. You want to make sure that you're closing it in the right version number. The first package that was uploaded to Debian, which actually fixed the bug. In general, you should be using version done messages as much as possible. This is because it tells the bug submitter why the bug was fixed, what version it was fixed, and all that good information. Otherwise, they're stuck seeing that the bug has been fixed, but gee, I didn't necessarily get an email about it. The fact that submitters don't get emails all the time is another thing that we'll talk about. And again, just to remind you how to set them. Okay, so one of the common questions that I get asked a lot is, why is my package still buggy? So you probably noticed that we changed the default display a while ago to show you what's going on and unstable. So if for some reason you don't like that, you don't have to append dist equals unstable to your URL. But this is an example. Most common case is that it hasn't built on all our architectures. So if you look at the header of a bugs.debian.org page for a package search, you can actually see the versions of the package that at least Debugs thinks is in the archive. And usually this is some architecture that you may not care about, like for a while SH was behind. But anyway, that'll tell you. If you don't care about any other architectures, you can also append arc equals i386, whatever architecture you think is important to your URL, and that'll only show you that one. If you still can't figure it out, the way to figure it out now is to look at the graphs. So this is an example of a graph that we've got going here. This happens to be glibc. It's an interesting thing to look at the graphs of. And so this is bug 419103. So can anybody look at that and tell me why that one still appears to be open, even though it's not? So this bug has been done. So you guys can go check it out. Look look at
it.
Let me see if I can.
Is it? Oh, did I close the browser? Upper left hand corner of the. There you go. And the other button. Buttons are
back. In version 2.5.
Yeah.
There's the browser window too there.
This one?
Yep.
So anyway, so what we can see here is that it's been closed in, closed in 2.5. So if we click on the graph, we can see that there's no record of a 2.5 version. Yeah.
That's actually kind of a bug. It was meant to do version number interpolation if they can't figure it out, but in this case it might be too hard.
Yeah, I mean, part of the problem is because if you have, you could always have a branch at 501 or something, so it's always hard to know exactly which version it should be closed in. So in this case, you should be sending a version done with 2.5-1. Since that's the first version in Debian that has it instead of 2.5. So if somebody wants to fix this, they can send a fixed message to this bug.
Now you're going to receive
fixed messages.
You're going to receive 15 of them.
So, So that's one example of a problem that people might run into. Another thing that we see occasionally is non-version done messages. Non-version done messages should only be used for invalid bugs. That means a bug that you didn't have to do anything at all to fix. It wasn't buggy, it was a bug in another package, something that doesn't require tracking at all by the stable release manager or the testing release manager. If you do that, it makes the release manager's job very difficult because they have no idea if this bug applies to testing, stable, or whatever. It also makes the user's job difficult because sometimes they want to know, hey, when was this bug fixed? It doesn't still apply to me. And if you use a non-version done, they can't figure that out. And at this point, I want to talk a little bit about the difference between buggy and done. For whatever reason, right now, there are two separate states in the BTS. One, whether a bug affects a particular version, and the other one is whether it's been done or not. That means whether you've sent a version done to the bug, or whether you've sent any sort of done message to the bug. So usually people or maintainers think that the done means that they are done with the bug. Okay, I've done whatever I needed to do, it's fixed, and eventually it'll be fixed in all the other architectures. Buggy just means that at that particular version, there still is a problem. Okay. So if you're not sure which is which, you can have a version or a bug which you have fixed, but still not sent a done message. So you haven't sent a message to bug number dash done. And that's the difference between the two. If you want the old appearance on your package report.cgi screens, you can just delete the distribution equals unstable or whatever, and all the only difference then will be between bugs which have been had a done message sent and not. Okay? Is that kind of clear?
No.
Okay.
Not at all.
So, bugs have two different states. One is the bug still existent at this version? That's buggy. Is it buggy or not? The second one, is the bug done or not? Has the maintainer sent a done message to the bug?
That fixed works too.
Fixed affects whether it's buggy or not. So if you send a fixed control message to the BTS, that does not affect the done state of the bug. That only affects whether it's present in a particular version or not. That's why you should not use fixed the first time around. So use done. I don't know if we should change that or not. Maybe we should.
Okay, so now I'm starting to understand why I've been so confused.
But in the general case, because most people close bugs in change logs, you don't care. Because it sets both that it's been fixed in a particular version and sets the done flag at the same time. Yeah. David, I guess that first.
So when you send a close message with a version number, does that also set the done state?
Yeah. Please don't use close.
Don't use close now.
Close, all it does is set the done. Well, it can do both, but it sets the done state. That's what the
close. Even when you append a version.
It can do both then. But the problem with using close is it doesn't send anything to the bug submitter.
Okay.
Cool.
Does this seem a little broken to anybody else?
That's what I should do.
Yeah.
One thought, Gamut is not in the rule, right? Because if this thing will get added to the new maintainer question about bug report, bug tracking system, like we have, we are going to have no more Debian developers passing an M. And but, which kind of gets to the second question, do we have a collection of recipes? Like, if you want to do this, this is actually the procedure. I mean, don't use close, don't use fix, use done. But in that case, use done, use close, not fix, not done.
So,
if you want to do this, here's a step-by-step.
So the step-by-step is in server control, so bugs/server control on the website, bugs/reporting on the website, and the general rule is don't use close.
Okay, do you have a list of bugs/something that documents something, but I think I can track ahead if I want
to. Yeah, well if you just go to bugs.debian.org and click through the top 5 links, that's all that's documented.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Is there still a difference in the way an amuse are handled from maintainer uploads?
The only difference, as far as I know, is I think we're still setting the fix tag. But in general, there is no difference as far as the BTS is concerned. Maintainer upload and a non-maintainer upload.
And the fixed tag is set for maintainer uploads only.
Non-maintainer
uploads.
Yeah, because it still has the unfortunately convoluted fixed and new. And that probably will change at some point in time to the original meaning of fixed. So. Okay, he wants to say something.
So now we've got doneness and not doneness, and we've got fixedness and non-fixedness, which apply to particular versions, and we've got a fixed tag, which doesn't apply to particular versions. Are there any plans to rationalize this at all?
Yeah, so I mean, part of the problem is I sort of inherited the system that had been grown up over a period of time. So right now, all the fixed tag means is fixed in and new. That's what it shows up when you look at it on the BTS. I don't know whether we should get rid of it entirely, whether it has no meaning, whether we should keep it as a maintainer, some state in between pending and fixed. I haven't decided. I mean, I'm open to input on that.
So this goes back to the discussion that you and I had online one day. And I've actually been one of the stronger supporters conceptually of the idea of having version bugs and all of the things that this would visibility by release managers and users, and you know, can I figure out what bugs still apply to the setup? continuing to be sort of logically straightforward and reasonable. And you know, I have to echo the sentiment that even with the things that have changed recently, it still makes my head hurt trying to figure out what it is to do on a given day with a given bug. So it seems like we still haven't quite gotten there. And maybe this is something that is a good topic for the BOF session as opposed to.
I definitely think that we should go over that. Because part of the problem, too, is, I mean, I look at it as a maintainer of dev bugs, so I know what a reasonable amount of the code in there does. So, I mean, I have a totally different mindset than people who actually use it without knowing the insides.
So I think one of the problems is that we started out doing the versioning system with the awareness that we had to keep compatibility with what people were doing at the moment. And one of the things we tried very hard to do at the start was make sure that the normal flow of closing bugs via changelogs worked properly, that we didn't have to go through and manage 100,000 bugs to fix up the states of all of them. In order to switch them over to a single new schema that would work better and be more comprehensible. But maybe it's time to acknowledge that we need to just go through a load of bugs automatically, fix up their states to something coherent, and basically have a flag day where we switch over to something that's a bit more sensible.
Yeah, it's definitely a possibility now as well.
Actually, as one of the, I would say, users of the version cycle, I'm quite happy with the current implementation. I know there are a few things that I don't like so much, but most of them, what I do quite often is I go through the bug list, and these are the RC bugs, and say, oh yeah, this one needs to be fixed because it looks a bit strange. A few minor things, but mostly, from my side, it's really working good. What perhaps is missing from EDA's side is that we need to make it easier for the maintainers, because for the release team, it's very good currently.
Right. No, I think part of the thing too is that the release team deals with the bugs on a daily basis, so you know exactly when it's broken and not.
Yeah, well, I understand how version tracking works anyway, so I even know how to work around any bugs that we have.
So when I thought about this, the one thing that I'll drop is an idea here, and then we really should probably defer the rest of redesigning this to a buff or something, is that the thing that's interesting about versioning bugs is that there's a version that matters a lot to the package maintainer that's not visible to the rest of Debian, which is the head of the source tree in that maintainer's revision control system. And so I think part of the struggle that I felt is that the view that I want to have of the state of bugginess of a particular package when I go to work on that package has really nothing to do with sort of the whole history of everything that's ever been uploaded to Debian. It's which of the bugs in the bug tracking system still apply to the source tree that I'm staring at right now, trying to make fixes and improvements in for the next upload. And so the thing that I think would be great in a BOF to wrap our brains around is, what does that actually mean? What's the right sort of, you know, path through the various state variables that we have here to get something as close to approximating that view as possible? And this comes back to the whole notion of when's the right time to close things, change their state, and so forth. I have found myself using tags and so forth in the bug triaging process so that I can approximate the notion of having a BTS understand the state of what I'm working on even before it's uploaded. And this is something I don't think we've completely explored. I don't exactly know what we would do differently, but.
Yeah, I mean, we can definitely talk about that, because I can kind of show you what I'm doing now, and I think a bunch of other people who use tag pending that Joe wrote, or did you write it?
I use it a lot.
Just a quick thought regarding the fixed tag. In a certain sense, seeing the new view on NMUs, which are not no more an unfriendly app, no more something that crosses a bit the line and everything, it probably makes sense to close the tag. I mean, the maintainer, if it doesn't acknowledge the NMU or doesn't like it, can just reopen it, right?
Oh yeah, the bugs are, I mean, it's exactly the same as a normal upload. So the bug is closed. The only difference is that currently, anyway, because I asked for it, but the tag is still there. And the only reason why I asked for the tag to be there menu, you can quickly see which bugs you need to look at before you make your next upload. But there's better ways of doing that. It's just they weren't more visible at that point. Yeah, sure.
So that comes back to what Peter was saying. So the reason why an AMU is difficult is because the maintainer is the only person who's allowed to assume that they can make an upload without first doing a download and checking what the most recent version is. And that's why the bug system needs to reflect whether or not this change has been made to the maintainer's tree, which is not visible anywhere else.
Right.
I partly disagree about it, and we have issues with AMUs currently, because what happens if the maintainer just uploads the source, he will just cut out from Debian and change logs in a new version, and magically all the bugs will reappear in unstable. Which helped us to fix about 20 to 30 SE bugs, where the maintainer just uploads NMU. So it actually just works. If the maintainer uploads this version, the bugs are reopened automatically. And that's a great thing about version for me.
Yeah, I think we should hold off on that discussion, I guess, a bit until the bot. I guess you have one last. Let me at least get through the recent enhancements, and then at the end we can come back to that, because I know there's a lot to talk about there. So some of the, well, semi-recent ones. Bug subscriptions have been around for a while. Version graphs, you probably all noticed that, because that's pretty visible when I made that change. I think Steiner actually started writing that, but I finished that up. Another thing that's been done is there's now a SOAP interface. Along with the modularization of dev bugs, I've started to expose more and more functions publicly using the SOAP interface. And this basically currently, well, I'll show you an example of all the different things it can do. If for some reason there's something you wanted to do, you want to query BTS using SOAP that isn't available yet, or for some reason you want some other aberration besides the aberration that SOAP is, you can tell me about it. Maybe I'll agree to add it as well. It's actually pretty simple. Another major thing that's been changing is I've started modularizing the code more and more and more. Part of that is because I can't handle uploading stuff or making changes to the live BTS when I can't test it beforehand. So I mean, even though I've broken the BTS more than enough in the past couple of years, if I wasn't able to do that, I would have broken it a lot more. One of the major changes that is still going now is versioning aware archival. I guess I should explain how this works a little bit. Basically, bugs are now archived if they are fixed by default in unstable and testing for at least 28 days and the bug is closed and no activity has occurred on the bug in 28 days. If the bug is important and it should not be archived until stable has fixed it, so until we release the new stable or pointer release or something, you can tag it the bug stable. And that will add stable to the set of releases that it waits until it can archive.
Stable or ash?
Stable. Wait. I think it's stable, actually.
Is that new tech?
No, maybe I broke that. Okay. I'll check that out. It'll either be ash or stable, and I'll correct the verbiage on the server control that explains the tags to indicate which is correct. But anyway, whatever tag ends up being either stable or edge, then if you set that, it will not archive. Along with that came the ability to unarchive and archive messages. So you can now unarchive any bug that you want to bug, unarchive. You could do this before, but it required bugging somebody with an owner hat, and I really don't like an archiving bugs. So this basically enables you to do that for yourselves. What goes along with it is the ability to archive bugs. You can archive any bug which has previously been archived, so long as the version requirements have been met. So it has to be fixed in whatever architectures or whatever distributions it's supposed to be fixed in. So that means that you can, in addition to having closed reopen cores, you can now have closed reopen archive. is
why archiving is there.
Oh yeah. So the reason why we archive bugs at all, well, there's a couple different reasons. The first and foremost is because it cuts down the number of bugs that get spam. So you can email any open bug, and if you're a spammer, for some reason they seem to enjoy doing that. Lars Larson in the back is basically responsible for eliminating however many gigabytes of spam we get a day, and reducing the number of unarchived bugs we have. It helps reduce that. Another thing is it also helps clean up the view that package maintainers see, because you do not care about a bug that you fixed a year ago in general that hasn't shown its head again. So this takes care of that as well, and so reduces the page load times. It also makes the searches faster and does some other things. Along with that, I'm almost ready to add a sort or to search in archive bugs and unarchived bugs at the same time. So if for some reason you really want to know them all, yeah, that can be done. One of the most recent things I committed is the ability to sort a bug by age. So if you add order equals age, or you select the order sorting option, you can now sort your bugs by age, which is the last time that anybody mailed the bug. Some people have asked for the ability to say, hey, when was the last time I emailed this bug? That's a little bit more difficult to do, so I don't know if I'm going to do that anytime soon, but this is pretty easy. Steiner Gunderson wrote the versioning aware bug scan, which basically tells you now exactly what bugs are open and stable, testing, unstable, and I think even experimental. We also have a mail system finally that's encoding aware. Took long enough. But now if you've got funny characters, in your name, your name works correctly, and the rest of it should work. Let's see. This test suite's one of great things. Oh, another cool thing we've got is the full text searching. So you can now search for anything in a bug anywhere with a whole bunch of neat additions using HyperStrayer, and I'll show you how to do that. We also have force merge support. Force merge, for those of you who haven't used it yet, it's probably a lot of you have. Basically, if you're one of those people who has users who don't check the BTS and submit 8 billion bugs, and you fix the first one so it's the way you want it, you can now just say, well, after you reassign it, because they probably use it. After you reassign it, because they probably assigned it to the wrong patch to start with, then you can force merge the bug number that's correct, and then all the other bugs that they've submitted. It'll change everything in the other bug to match the first bug that you would have to normally change for merging. We also have searching now by owner. I don't know if anybody uses that besides TVM, but it's there. And we're also getting rid of the boring information. So things that are messages, the useless header information that we used to show doesn't show up anymore. I mean, you can have it show if you want it, but it's not there by default. And we also don't show the message received by sent to messages anymore, but you can toggle those on. They're actually in the HTML, you just use the JavaScript to put them on. Here's the version graphs if you haven't seen them. Green is fixed, the red is borked, and the gray is met. It doesn't know what it is, so by default it doesn't show you the gray, but if you now click ignore boring on the version graphs, it'll show you the boring. And we also do collapsing. So if you see the sum versions, then let's see. In there. So this is a whole bunch of versions which have been collapsed there. So if you actually uncollapsed it, you would see all the different versions in between. So now we have, you can select user tags using it. You can do bug searching or selection. And you can also pull the bug status currently. So, and anything else that you're interested in pulling, if so, for your own private application, let me know. Here's a SOAP example. It's pretty simple. most of it's pretty easy. So, the basic thing is this is the actual method that you call. And so, this actually returns the status for this bug. This part's not totally documented, but bug, 300,000, who closed it, the version that it was found in, fixed, et cetera, and it just keeps going and going. So you can run that code really quick, and you can see the output that it generates and the sort of stuff that you can pull out from this. There are a couple other functions, and they're documented in the dev bugs so far. And maybe if I have time, I'll write documentation for them. Test suite, okay, this is for me primarily, but actually brings up a running BTS and sends mail. It actually makes it much more simpler now to bring up a running BTS. You don't actually even need a configuration file anymore. There's a configuration module that sets same or relatively same defaults for almost everything. It just does it. And yeah, basically avoids breaking the BTS and trivial things. And the hyperstringer backend, so this is now running on Raquel. See if I can get this to work.
Good luck. Wait, it's Tilda?
Yeah.
It's on the funny little Japanese key up on the upper right hand corner.
So this is the full text search. There's actually a link to it from the bugs.debian.org webpage if you don't remember this URL. But some of the neat things that you can do, obviously you can search for yourself. So let's do that. So this is actually using a hyperstrator based backend. It's kind of a neat little full text searching thing. But basically, you can use it to search the BTS this way, and you can add all sorts of native attributes. So for example, if you're interested in some very important bugs, so you can search for bugs that contain my name. It's very important. So it's a little slow when you add the constraints, but it's there eventually. And so you can add basically infinite number of constraints and dial down your search to the ones that you want.
What I'm missing on this page is some info on which format dates should be entered and stuff like that.
Okay.
Would it be possible to add that? Because if you don't know what's behind it, it's practically impossible to use constraints like that at the moment. You have this drop-down list of all kinds of options, equal to string, fuzzy matches, whatever. And basically, I don't know which should be used with which attribute.
Okay.
So please add some information about it.
Sure, yeah. Yeah, it's more difficult with hyperstray itself because you actually have to know its query language. So this is a step above, but I'll definitely add that.
Well, you could just use JavaScript to, if you select severity, you just get a small amount of things you could select. But what I originally wanted to say is that what I would like to say is something like, I want severity, but only if it's less than normal, or only if it's larger equals important, or whatever.
Yeah, I don't. There's not currently a metric to select the severity, to select the severity greater than using this. But you could do that using other methods. So yeah, just go ahead.
One last comment. I think I'm not sure if that's still the case, but I've done searches, and if I then change something in the search conditions and search it again, if I browse to a later page, it would show a later page by default instead of going back to page one, which is kind of a problem when you restrict things, and you don't have that number of pages anymore. then go back up, it will first keep on displaying the last page endlessly before you finally get back to the first page.
Yeah,
there's something weird there.
Yeah, I thought I'd fix something like that at one point, but yeah, if you get one of that, just email me the URL that you're at, and then I'll definitely look at it.
Okay, excellent.
Oh yeah, this is sorted by age, so this I've just added, so you can now append order equals age or select it from the menu. In the URL is ungodly complicated, and one of the things that needs to happen is a much better way to add all of these neat options that Package Report has without looking at the source code to find them. And the select options at the bottom are sort of a start towards that, but more work needs to be done on that. So you can see here this huge URL that I've got does something that's kind of neat. First, it's sorting by the last time the bugs are modified. And you'll notice as well, the bottom here, that I don't have any bugs that I've fixed listed here. So,
yeah.
And no bugs as well that I've fixed in my upstream source, because they're all tag pending. So, that's how you do it. But I'll show you guys how to do this in Buff, and probably fix the this little options thing at the bottom so that you can do it more easily.
Why don't you just like blog it or something?
Yeah, my blog hasn't been updated in 3 years, so gotcha. But anyway, that's an example.
Yeah, good luck. There you go. There's something going on with that.
Okay, so future stuff. More so methods. I know there's some people who are doing neat stuff like Mark and we're planning to do neat stuff with PTS. So they need more so methods. One of the things I'm trying to do is control abstraction. And that means that ripping out all the neat commands that you can do with the control mail so that you can also do that to some extent in messages that you sent to bug number, so that in the same message that's sent out, you can do them all. That's happening slowly. another thing that we'd like to do, or kind of thinking about doing, is integration with Yoram's mole that he's been talking about. One of the questions that we had is the ability of maintainers to add specific information to the tops of bug pages of packages that they maintain, so that if there's something that you wish bug submitters would do, or information that you'd like to give to people browsing the bug pages would help that out. Another bigger thing that a lot of people have asked for is better statistics. And that's something that we need to do. And the other things are templates for all output. So all of the output that BTS produces now is hard-coded into the code, which is obviously suboptimal. And that means that it's rather difficult to make small changes to the output format, because you have to make them in about 100 different places. But one of the bugs we've got right now is appending a URL at the bottom of every single email that's sent out. And in order to make that change, I have to change it in, I think, 30 different places, which is a little too many. So that's one of the changes that hopefully we'll make. And the final one, of course, is more documentation. And that's something that everybody here can help out with. It's pretty easy to do.
I'm available if you want later to try and comment something like give me bug reports similar to this one. I have no idea if the results would be useful or not, but it's like for the implement, so.
Sure. And so here's some information on how you can help. That's what the source is. It's all on BZR right now. It's much better than it was in CBS. I don't know, we may change again, but at least BZR is kind of working. Most of the functions that have been added are now documented with pod, so you can kind of get a handle better on what the source code is doing. Send patches, and that explains how to fix our documentation. And with that, I'd like to thank the rest of the DevLux team. All these people have done work at some point in time. Ian Jackson has also done work, as is Darren. think I still have some time for some more questions, so I guess if there are any more questions, we can go ahead. Yeah.
I have a comment about salt interface. Mm-hmm. I am using a salt interface in apt-listbooks. I think it's one of the only software which uses the salt interface in Debian stable distribution. So if you change the interface now, it will break the package in stable.
Yeah, that's actually something that I've cognizant of and trying to avoid, or trying to come up with a good way to handle multiple API versions. And so, because I've already gotten caught out with it once with the report bug that was directly parsing the HTML to bug report or something. And so, by the way, if you're doing that in your packages, please stop, tell me, and I will write SOAP code or something for you, because I hate special casing stuff. But yeah, I will definitely be compatible in some way with list bugs and stable.
For the statistics thing, I was wondering if you were aware, if the audience is aware, of David Martinez Moreno's Ender's graphs that he's been doing. He started tracking, at least for some packages, like I believe the installer, and he's been doing all the X-Strikeforce packages. He's been graphing closures in certain aspects and modifications for us. And it's really been helpful in terms of seeing, you know, the kind of work that's been going on. So maybe you should talk to him and sort of take some of his code and see if he can integrate it.
Yeah, definitely. But one of the things that is always useful is figuring out what people are going to use the statistics for, because that helps me when I'm looking at what I can write or what I should be writing.
Graphs are good.
So I think one of the major drawbacks of our BTS right now is the time gap between the time you perform an action, like via email, and the time the action get performed on the real data. And I understand that this is kind of intrinsic in the architecture of Debugs, but I just wonder if you thought there's a way we can improve it, like, I don't know, a queue mechanism or something like that,
okay,
so that the user can see the effect of its actions.
So right now, when Expire is not running, as it's been running for the past couple days, it's basically running and stopping every 2 hours, so stuff gets processed. But in general, bugs are processed every 3 minutes. So it used to be every 15, now it's every 3. So in general, it should be fast enough to see instant response. But if you're not seeing fast response right now, it's why. It's because once this expire runs, then it'll be back to normal for the most part. Yeah.
At times, the physical amount of spam we are getting is taking enough time to process to cause, at times, hours of backlog. I've been rewriting the spam scan code to reduce that, and can now process spam assassin on 20 bugs at a time. And we've got a faster machine and more RAM and so on and so forth to help with this problem.
Yeah. In general, unless we've got some crazy DOS going on, it's usually relatively quickly. Or the normal state of DOS that we have for running on. Any additional questions?
The mailing list currently rejects MailSend from so-called daemon addresses like root, daemon add, and so on. However, the BTS happily accepts them, which means that such mails do get into the BTS, but do not get to the intended receivers if the maintainers are a mailing list. It would be great if that could be synced so that either both reject them or both accept them. And to be honest, I think it's more logical to have the BTS reject them the same way that the lists do, as it's basically a spam measure. And people shouldn't be sending from root addresses anyway.
Yeah, the problem, it's kind of a two-part thing because we don't actually bounce, because we can't bounce immediately. Well, I guess we could probably start bouncing immediately. That's something we could work with DSA to change the XM setup for the BTS to do that. Yeah, because we'd have to bounce them immediately. Any additional questions?
Just a comment to what he just said, and out of personal interest, the filter you're mentioning is also rejecting the plain local path mail, which is more and more common for people who use their name in the domain, and then it's mail at. So if you're changing that, then you might, I agree that mail daemon or anything should be rejected, but just mail at is quite common for real addresses, and a lot of users use it, so if their BTS mails would be blocked, would be confusing for them. Just a note for that.
The problem is that it's included in default portmail alias, so it's kind of hard to use that filter and then still accept from certain parts that are part of that default portmail alias. So it's either activate the default portmail feature or not use it.
Okay. So thank you very much for your attention. Don't forget the BAF tomorrow at 11. Feel free again as well if you have feature requests that you think of after the BAF or between now and the BAF to file bugs on DevBugs or bugs.debian.org and I'll summarily close that for you.